We are counting down right now. We sure are. Let's see if we're here.
We have 10 people tuning in right now. That's pretty good audience.
That's pretty good.
Yes.
So far.
Yeah. It looks like we are live. Just want to verify that. Are we on?
Mm-hmm.
Looks like it.
Can you see? Everybody can see except me?
I see.
It's my stream.
Yeah, you need to control it. You need to see.
All right. It looks like we are on. We are live. Sophia and Catherine have joined us here today. Dan Hinnon is going to be joining us. So go ahead, Catherine. I'm going to let you take it away from here. You can see my screen.
Yes, I can see it. Thank you, Greg. And I'm glad you're here, Sophia and Greg, both of you, and we'll be glad when Dan can join us too. The one thing I want to say first is that this is not a video that is meant for children. If you are under the age of 18, even watching this once it's uploaded, please turn it off. It's not for you to see. And if you're squeamish, please don't watch either, because we're going to be showing some actual crime scene photos. So here we go. And it's, do you see what I see? I was going through photos. It was someone in the group had mentioned a while ago, and about the shadows and the carpet from the decomp fluid. And someone else had sent me and said, do you see anything? And at the time I said no, because I was focusing on something else. I just didn't have time to look at it. So this past weekend I decided, you know, I think I'll go back and revisit that topic. And as I'm looking at the photos of the decomp stains in the rug, for some reason the skull piece caught my eye, and I start flipping through those photos. And this is what, well, this is what I see in the first photo. We can go to the first one of the skull. Here we go. This one right here. And I do believe this is photo BCA4760. And I'm looking at it. Yep.
Greg, we don't see it on YouTube.
You're not seeing it on YouTube?
Mm-mm.
No video.
No, I can see the first slide, but I can't see the slide of the skull. The one that Catherine's talking about.
Do you see it now? I see it on YouTube.
Yes, yeah. It's there now.
Okay.
It just...
That was weird.
Is this the delay you were talking about, Greg, that it would take a few seconds?
It could be. Yeah, I'm looking at both of them right now just to make sure.
Okay.
So I'm trying to look at it on YouTube and seeing what everybody else would see. But this is BCA4760 that we're looking at here. So this is BCA4760. Very disturbing image for many reasons.
Yes, it's extremely disturbing. And this is why I really wanted to stress that, you know, if you're squeamish, don't look at this. This is David's skull piece, or skull pieces. But I noticed, I started looking at the skull piece lying on the page of the Quran that was torn out. And then I look at the next photo. Now, I think what Greg has done is he's, you know, we've got this outer, and then he zooms in closer and closer, which is really good. Now, what I want you guys to look at, and toward the left side, and maybe a little bit more toward the top where it says summary, which is right next to the skull piece. Yes, there you go. That word right there. Please take note of that word summary, and then just take notice of where this skull piece is located. And let's look at the next slide. Same one, but now Greg is focusing in on the middle section of the skull piece where it kind of makes a V, where his cursor is right now. I also want you to keep an eye on this spot as well. Okay, next slide.
Same one, I'll skip that one. Okay, BCA4762.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's this next photo. And we'll look at it again. We'll get a close-up. This is the further away for it. Now it's closer. Notice the word summary. And notice where the V section is cut out in the skull piece. You should start to notice something here. And let's go to the next slide. Okay, this is a close-up, which this is a great close-up. Thank you. This is excellent. And notice that what word you can clearly see within that V shape, which is with. Okay, next slide, please. 4763.
And for the audience, we'll add these pictures to the group so that you can examine them close up.
Yes, exactly. Now let's look at the word summary on this page. It's a little hard to see on this close up, but right there, notice summary. Do you see that gap between the skull piece and where summary begins? And now you can see the word pharaohs. Weren't able to see that in the first photo.
In
We're
BC.
Still waiting for the slides to catch up.
Okay.
Okay.
Nova Coco is saying right on. Would you want me to go back and compare this one to?
Yes, let's compare this one back to 4760, the very first photo. And this is what I really want. This is what caught my eye. Notice how close that skull piece is to the word summary, and you can't even make out the word pharaoh. You see O-H apostrophe S, but that's it. Now let's look at 4764, which I think was the last one we were looking at. Can you go back? Yeah, go to 4764. And there we go. Now let's do the close-up of this one. Now look at that. You now see SES colon pharaohs, magicians. And notice where the word down in the V shape, where the word with is now located. It is no longer within the center of that. This entire skull piece has been moved three separate times. And it's all been documented with their photography and in their photos. When I saw this, needless to say, I was kind of like shocked, because there is, from what I could read in the documents, I do not see where, first of all, where these skull pieces are even documented or noted, other than in the autopsy reports where it says that skull pieces were found and brought in with David's body, and then put together and fit with what the remaining skull on him. That's the only place where I see any written documentation of the skull pieces at all. Now they're clearly photographing them, and they're photographing them on this page of the Quran. But am I the only one? Now, I can't hear or see if anybody else is typing or asking any questions, but do you guys see what I'm trying to point out here? The difference in where this skull piece has been located and how it's been moved?
Catherine,
what are your thoughts?
Let me read to you some of those, some of the comments that are coming in here.
Okay.
Nova Coco is saying, it's moved. The skull has clearly moved. Paulette Brown is saying, are you saying there is some message in the way they have placed the skull piece?
You know, I've been thinking about that a lot myself, and I don't know if Greg and Sophia have an input on that, but I don't know at this point in time. All I can see is that the skull piece has been moved. There you go. It's perfect. Here we see the very first photo in the word summary. And down where the little cutout V section is, you don't even see the word with at all. So is it something they're trying to show us? I don't know. Were they spelling something? Go ahead, Greg.
James is asking a question that I also had the same question. Is it because of the angle? Is it because of the angle of the picture?
It can't be that, and for this main reason, because we are looking at the same, the angle is straight on in every single one of these photos. They're taking it from an upper position and looking down on the skull piece onto the to the paper, and on this, and with it moving that much, it can't be related to that. It just can't, it doesn't work that way with a photograph. You would have to be tilted. The photo would have to be taken askew from a different angle, and it's not. It's going from up, looking straight down. And if you want to go ahead and slowly go through those photos again from the not exact, the ones that are farther away, not necessarily close up. See, look there. It's clearly not about an angle. Here we have summary. Again, just look at how those, that word, how it changes, how you see more. You'll begin to see pharaohs. Now that can't be angle, because P-H-A-R is underneath the skull cap, and now here it's completely out from underneath it. And the word with, which was not even visible in 4760, the first photo, is clearly visible in the other three. And you see where it actually is moved. In this photo, I believe that this one is actually lower. The skull cap is moved lower on the page.
Right.
And, yeah.
Let me see if there are any other questions, anything.
They were talking about maybe slowing down and showing the close-ups again a little bit longer so that we all could examine it.
Okay, sounds good.
And I'd like to welcome everybody to the live stream. We have 20 people.
Wow, 22.
A second ago, 22. We did.
Welcome, everyone.
I think this one is important, so you can kind of see, and I tried to tilt it kind of where we're going to look at 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, so you can get a good view of where those items are, and then where David's body is, because that's, like you said, that's the only body that's really close to where all of that is.
Yes, that's the great idea.
Okay, so 4760, taken by BCA specialist Mike Katsevich. taken on 1/17/2015, taken at 19:04:31 Central Time.
And I want to add in here that those timestamps are going to come into play in one of our next up. This is going to be a series, two or three different videos on just these four photos. So we will revisit those timestamps because it's more interesting information in the metadata. Sophia, since you're you can see what the others are seeing on YouTube, would you please let us know when to change slides?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
And they would like to see side-by-sides eventually.
Yep.
So I just am passing that message along.
Okay. And right here, it's real important to notice you do not see the word with. You do not see pharaohs.
Yeah, and what was frustrating about this one is I couldn't get a really good image of it.
And you can't because the photo's out of focus.
Okay.
And it's pretty bad out of focus. So the fact that you got it as good as you did is, you should be, it was a good job. You did a good job.
Okay. Thank you. About time I did something right. Okay, this one, I think, this one's a little bit more clear. But yeah, I mean, pharaohs, you can't see it. Even if I move to the right, to the left, because I was thinking that too, you know. And these are all questions that we need to ask. It's,
correct.
I think it's a good, it's just, it's interesting for many reasons. Okay, so we're still looking at it. This one is kind of tilted. This is more kind of at an angled view. So this is what it would look like, and you still can't see pharaohs. So
right, and this is just a different, yeah, this is just where the picture itself was turned, and when you did the close-up, this was not a turn of the camera taking a different photo. And and notice where the part of the skull is, where you see the word light, where the top of that skull just before it starts to come down, and then you see summary. Yes, notice how that moves down as well.
Right, so now light, I can see mood. Couldn't see mood before, couldn't see any of this before. Now
Yep.
there's three photos that you're talking about. 4760, that's the one where everything looks different. 4762, 4763, and 4764 all look like this, correct?
Yes, and each one is moved just a little bit more.
Really?
Each photo is like this one. You will see just part what you can, what we know now as an S because we see the other pictures, but you really just see colon arrows. And then when you go further, then eventually ends up being SES,
Okay, so
colon arrows.
we'll look at 4763,
763. Yes,
and
let's look at
then
that one.
we'll look at that. And this one I couldn't get it too well, but
Yeah, that one, yeah. And if you look again, we know because we see in the last one where you see ES colon pharaohs. And you see where the top of that skull piece, I'm sorry,
that's okay. I was gonna say
yeah, where you see
yeah, can't
this
see
and
that.
in 4763, that was 4762, yes, in this photo. And you see the top of that skull piece, look how far down, and you see light and mood and where that piece was actually up, you see what I'm saying? It's
Yeah.
moved down quite a bit. And then you see, looks like to be part of an E and an S. And that's 47. Oh, yeah, there it goes. And then you see the word with now, where it wasn't there before in the first photo.
Right, and that was still 4763. Now we're looking at 4764, which I think is probably the one that has more.
Yes.
Yeah, now I can see the SES instead of just
Yes.
the ES. I see. It's moving
And
at.
then the very first one, when you compare it, remember, it was you could barely make out the O, and then you had H apostrophe S in 4760. That's how
47.
far it has been moved to the left and down.
Greg, can you stay on the photos a little bit longer, please?
Sure.
Several in the audience are trying to get a good look, and sorry, it was going too fast for them.
Oh no, that's okay.
I can go back too. I can start over if that helps. If there's a place you want me to go back to.
The close-up that you were on just a minute ago that you were talking about, we barely had a glimpse at it, and then it moved again.
This one probably. It's
I
very
think so.
blurry.
The audience will tell us.
Yes. Start over. Okay.
Yeah,
I'm gonna start
and that's
over.
okay.
I had
I
to
mean,
do
how
this
many
too.
times?
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. I'm still
We
doing
really want
it.
everybody to understand what we have seen, and this
What
is
these
why I want.
photos, yes, what these photos are telling you. This isn't our opinion. This isn't anything. This is evidence. And what is that evidence saying? It's saying a whole lot. And it unfortunately, it's not boding well for whoever is responsible. And that's just it. We may never know who is responsible. And I can give my guess, but I'll give my opinion when we're done with this. But for now, I just we all felt it was really important that all of you guys see, and do you see what we see? Are you seeing what the evidence is showing? Well, at least to me, I can't speak for Greg and Sophia.
Okay, so I'm
Okay.
starting from the
Greg.
top now. Yes.
Okay.
Starting from the very top. And I'm gonna hold each slide for about 30 seconds for everybody.
Perfect.
Okay, except for this one. 4760.
Okay, just a second. There's a delay for YouTube.
Oh, you're right. Okay. You guys will see it in about. Wow, there's a bigger delay than I thought. Sorry, guys. That's okay. They won't notice. People in the replay won't notice it. All the people that are
Okay.
sleeping right now waiting to watch it won't notice. Okay, now we're on the same. 4760. That's what they're seeing now. And the area we're going to focus in on is right in here. This little bugger. And the words that are moving along the edge. Okay, we're going to look at the same image, zoomed in just a little bit here. And as clear as I could get it, zooming in. Still looking at 4760. Like Catherine is saying, look at where light is. Look at where summary is. And this
you cannot see with.
You cannot see with. No. You cannot see. Alright. And we're going to look at the same image a little bit closer up here. Just a little bit zoomed in, and I'll hold this one for about 30 seconds. Okay. Now we're looking at the exact same image, and this time instead of me turning it or flipping it, all I did was basically try to zoom in and try to get the exact same image. So we're still on 4760. That hasn't changed. That's all we're looking at here. Because that was my thought was, well, it's got to be like an angle. It's got to be something like that. There has to be a logical explanation. And there is. There is an explanation for everything. Whatever the truth is, there's got to be a reason for it. So, okay. Now we're going to look at 4762. And at 1904. So these are taken within seconds. Milliseconds, mm-hmm. Sorry.
Which doesn't add up.
We'll get
to that in a different...
Right.
Right, and we have to remember, these are just extra photos. There are photos in between these that were taken. So this is why we'll discuss that metadata later. But this is why this is really important.
Yeah. Okay, so this is 4762 that we're looking at now. The second of four images that Catherine is having us focus on. And of course you can tilt your head here and kind of see what's on those words, but I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to tilt it for you. Zoom in a little bit. Now we can see where light is. We couldn't see mood. There was no mood before. Now there is. Look at the S, just a semicolon and an S. That's it.
Okay, we're still waiting for that.
That's okay.
To come up.
That's all right.
There we go. We're getting closer.
Okay, so now you see that. You see where the summary is. Pay attention to all of the... It's just these words. I mean, if you focus on these words and where they are, it's like Catherine's right. Everything is moving. And... this piece is not going to move on its own. I'm going to guess on that.
Exactly. You're right. It doesn't move on its own.
It's a pretty safe guess, I think.
Right. And there's one thing I want to throw in here. We did not show photo 4761 because it's just a picture of one of the ripped pages. There, it doesn't have anything to do with this skull piece. So that is not part of it. So that's why it's photo 4760. 4762, 4763, and 4764.
Yep. Okay, now we're going to stay, we're still on the same image here, and we're just going to look a little bit closer to where the width is. And this is important here. Just go back, see where the width is, because even the width is going to change a little bit.
Yes.
So. Prophecy. Okay, now we're going to go to BCA 4763 and we're going to look at what that is. So this is a few milliseconds after. Okay, 4763 also shows the same thing, but it's how, I don't know.
Paulette asks, Catherine, why is the skull piece being moved around? What is the point?
I wish we could answer that. I really do, but The only thing I can tell you for certain is that it should never have been moved, and if it was moved, say by accident, it should have been documented, the movement of that skull piece, and, you know, clear comments about what happened and why. However, when we revisit these photos and we talk about the timestamps, we'll go into a little bit more a little more detail about what my theory is, but it's not good. There's no reason for this skull piece to have been moved at all. And if it was on accident, how would it get moved by accident in four different photos that are consecutive? It just doesn't happen that way in a crime scene, so... If you guys feel free to notate your theories too, because maybe you'll think of something we haven't.
Well, Elle had mentioned that it's possible that they could have been pulling on the fabric, and maybe that might have been why the skull piece kept moving.
Well, I'm not sure why they would be pulling on the scarf.
Correct.
So there would be no reason while they're documenting the crime scene to pull on anything. They're supposed to take everything in situ. And if things, sometimes things do get moved. It happens. But I've never seen it like this. Four different photos in consecutive order, seconds apart, this much movement with no documentation. In fact, they don't even mention the skull piece other than in the autopsy reports. Something's not right. This was not handled correctly at all. And so my question, and what I would like to know, why did they move it, and who was responsible for the movement?
And we can say with certainty that it wasn't Paleo moving this.
Correct.
Because it was already removed from the crime scene.
Correct. Thank you for bringing that up.
He
exactly.
wasn't there when they
the
were taking photos?
I'm sorry, what, Greg? I didn't hear you.
I was saying, so he wasn't there while they were taking photos.
Correct. He was taken out right away at the very beginning.
He was taken before anybody entered the house.
Yes, mm-hmm. supposedly.
That's what my cat says, anyway.
That's what your cat says.
She's saying something. I'm sure it's that. Yeah. So we're still... Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Nova Coco said... I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name. I'm sorry about that. My brother is a cop and also has done crime scene photos, and they are never allowed to move anything.
Let's see. Thank you. Thank you for clarifying that. That means a lot. So the fact that these are moved, were they moved by BCA? Since he's the one who's taking the photos, was it moved by a police officer? And there has to be some human intervention. And why? There should be, again, no reason why this should have happened. And it's clear this skull cap piece has been moved. But again, within seconds, and these are only some of the photos, which means there are more photos we don't have that fit within their supposed timestamp, which makes it even more difficult to explain the movement. Because they have even less time now to manipulate if those timestamps are correct. Again, we'll revisit that the next time. But I really want to bring everyone up to speed and show them this set of evidence. It just blows my mind.
Yeah. And still looking at 4763, that's what we've been looking at here. And then the next image is still going to be 4763. It's just turned. I tried to turn it, and it just did not come out right. I mean, this is one of the... It's just really hard. I know it's hard to see on my big screen here, so I know for people looking at it, it might be hard to see. But everybody has these photos. Everybody can get these four photos, and you know, you can see it all for yourself. Very clearly.
I know that they're on Dan's website. They're on your blog also, Greg.
Mm-hmm.
And either Catherine or I will upload these photos to the group, the ones that we're talking about tonight.
Nice.
The only thing I don't have is close-ups. So if you want to share them with me, Greg, then
Okay.
the actual close-ups, I can.
Yeah, I can send you all.
I'll be happy to.
They should all be in that PowerPoint, and maybe I can do something to kind of put some side-by-side comparisons here where I can show you what Catherine is talking about. Put 4760 on the left and then just kind of put the other three on the right. Well, I'll work on
That would be
something like that.
great. Yeah, that
Yeah.
would be great.
Okay. So that was 4763. Now we're gonna go to the last one here, 4764. So here's 4764. This is the raw image. And again, if you turn your head and compare that one to 4763, it's almost like this skull piece in this image is moving to the south
Yeah.
constantly on its own.
It's only
You know, I don't know. I mean, if they're stepping on that shawl there, you know, maybe it's causing it to move. It is on the shawl, but
Yeah, but the that would be very difficult. That piece of skull is going to be heavier than the scarf. And the fact, I mean, and they're not supposed to be moving evidence as they're taking photos of it. And that looks to be what, maybe, well, okay, I won't guess because from here it looks like a half an inch moved, but it could only, I don't know. I'd have to measure the paper. But that would be a whole lot of dragging on a scarf to pull a skull piece.
Yeah, I don't
And
think
if,
it
oh,
moves moving that
that was
much.
another thing I wanted them to notice too, not only the words, but the piece of hair. Remember that piece of hair that's right there toward the bottom, by
By
that
which word?
stuffing?
Oh, okay.
It's actually
From
on the carpet at the very top, down by the skull piece. There you go. But see
Okay.
that piece of hair
Yeah.
that's, it's, yeah, it's down a little bit more.
This one here.
There, that's it. That piece of hair. Notice how that moves as well. I forgot about that, or otherwise we would have been talking about that this whole time too. But as Greg goes through these photos again, notice how that skull piece moves down and exposes that hair compared to what it was in the first, well, what I call the first photo, but it's the first photo we have, number 4760.
Okay, so 4760 flipped on its side here, and now it's moving away. Now you can see the SES, even the width where this little piece right here was above the eye in one of the other photos, I think. I mean, isn't it good that they're taking a photo every time that it's moved? Isn't that what they're supposed to do? W regardless of if, you know, why it's moved, what they're doing, all that stuff. Isn't that a good sign that they're actually photographing it when they move it?
If they were doing that and moving the skull for a reason, and then they would have documented that. They would have said, oh, well, we turned it over to get a photo of the backside. So then we put it back and then we took a picture of it this way. There is no documentation of what they did with this skull piece in any of the reports, on anything.
Right.
So they should not have moved it at all.
Do
Period.
they have to, whenever they move something, do they have to document it? Where do they document it, and where would we look for that type of documentation? Not in the police
Well,
reports that
I
we
would,
got, right?
if I was to look at it, or to look for it, I would look for it in the BCA information. That big file that we got, they were the ones taking the photos.
Yeah, I mean, they documented the bullets, right? They documented the casings. They found it. They found that in the living room. It's by, and it's indicated by either tent number, whatever, or marker number, whatever. With this skull piece, there is no identifying this at all in any of the evidence, period. And the fact that they have time, again, we'll cover this more with the timestamps, and it's, I guess that's why Dan really wanted us to do this in bits and pieces, because it's a whole lot to try to take in with just once. And we will explain this, the was it moved routine on purpose and were they documenting, when we discuss the timestamps, because you will see, according to their timestamps, that is impossible. Again, their evidence, their documentation, their typing, impossible.
Okay, still looking at the same image, just a little bit closer up here, so you can see exactly where that width is, where the eye is, all that. So.
Yeah, and while we're looking this, I want to throw out there that, is it okay if we use her name or not, who pointed out the, again, this will be something we'll cover too, but while people are looking and or waiting, how the blood stain on the right, where it runs through the top, where you see the stuffing with hair on it, and then that little line of blood staining that runs through the words, was the host truth, you know, that type of stuff. That is an extremely interesting mark as well, and it's like, how did that get there? And was that the original placement of the skull piece? We just have no idea, but don't think so, because I think she brought up a really good point where if that truly had been, you know, there would have been more blood, since the skull piece is removed. So there's a lot of information in this photo. It seems simple at first, but there's a lot of truth-telling here to be seen if you just look.
Couldn't that be from the dog? Moving the headpiece over. I mean, the dog is credited with eating the heads.
I know, isn't that funny? And then I was thinking about this morning. It's like, oh, this poor dog. Not only is he blamed with eating this, but when you look at those pieces that are left, there's quite a bit of David's skull left. What is missing is just the front part of his face. And it's like, why? I mean, a dog would not choose to eat, you know, the forehead and the nose and the eyes, and that's it. I mean, their story just doesn't fit any way they spin it. It's like the more we see and the more we're discovering, the more the story, the official narrative, just is impossible.
Okay, here's one we haven't gotten to yet. DSC-254, photo taken by the AVPD. Did they not take any photos of what we just saw, or are those just ones that we didn't get? I guess they took like 800 photos, so we only got 464.
I didn't see any. That's what I was looking. I went back to their photos to see if I could find any skull ones, and I didn't see anything.
There's no Quran photos. There's nothing of the blood wall. Nothing like that. We didn't get any of that in the 464. I don't believe. I could be wrong.
And Greg, will you please explain to everyone why you felt this one was important?
I personally felt this one was important because of the number one marker, which obviously is not that to me. Okay, so if we look at the 4, the 5, this is a number 1 here. It's hard to see because of that glare, but it's still there. Mm-hmm. And then you have the 6 there. So it's kind of separate because number 1 is the gun. Are we to believe that the gun was here, or have they already been, it looks like they've already been moving everything. You know, and there's a couple other photos where some of these markers are actually flipped over, so it's like they're pretty much done with that area. So
yeah,
maybe.
But I think that makes lots of sense, though. I mean, now they're showing us at least what area, general area, the gun was located.
If they hadn't moved this marker from where number one was when they found that gun.
Correct.
Because
correct.
Okay,
good point.
So let's look, because 4, 5, 6. 7 is way over here now, and then I should have kept that drawing at the end too. I moved it all the way to the front. So, yes, I'm scrolling very fast, but for a reason, for a purpose. Okay. So here, right? Four, five, six, seven. They're saying they have that one marker over here. So by that point, this has all been moved because this is number one right here. So
Yeah.
they're moving, and so that was my other question was, okay, then when we look at these markers, are these markers moving?
That's a good question. I didn't even look at the markers, to be honest with you. I was too busy focusing on the skull piece.
Yes,
But good question.
I started looking at the markers, and in these four photos, I don't believe that they were moving, but I haven't it's just like it's all go back to that one. Obviously it's moved there, but yeah.
And another reason why we showed that very last photo with the body bag
Yeah.
was to show that the skull piece had already been removed from the crime scene. It was bagged when David was bagged, and it was put into a paper bag at that time and then was put in along with him, I think. Was it along with him, or did
Yes,
they
it
carry it?
was. No, it was put inside his body bag with him.
Well, I don't
At
know
least
if they
according to
state
the
that.
autopsy report.
I
I'm
mean,
sorry.
they. I don't know if they state that, but there were
It's in the
skull.
autopsy.
Yeah, but there's skull pieces that are consistent found with both of them. So there's some that they found next to the wife too. Now, obviously, those
Yes, but
ones look
this.
closer to where David was. That's why you think they were
Right.
bagged with David.
Well, that's the reports state that the pieces of bones that were found closest to whichever body it was bagged and placed with that body.
Right.
And then when the medical examiner during the autopsy takes that bag out, takes out the bone fragments, and it clearly states in both autopsies, both David and Camille's, David's it says that they took out the pieces, and they mention large pieces of bone, which, like, okay, it's the skull, and they say that it articulates well with what's remaining of his calvarium. And with Camille, there is no mention of matching any bone fragments to her skull at all.
There's
None.
some mention of big head pieces or some
That's on
something like that.
David's.
No, that's on hers
Yes,
too,
that
though. There's something on hers too like that.
I
There's.
did not read that in hers, and I'm gonna get her autopsy reports because if I'm wrong, I need to fix that. But it's not something I ever remember seeing. Let me hold on. Yeah, okay, here we go. Autopsy reports.
Yeah, yeah, large skull fragments are mentioned in Camille's autopsy.
Where? Do you see it?
Yeah.
It says, hers, it says, bone fragments are received in a sealed brown paper bag and states bone fragments near her body. The bag contains multiple commingled bony fragments, including a portion of dark wavy hair and white cotton debris. Amongst this bony material are two mandibles. One shows numerous restorations. In addition, there are two fragments of bones with two and four teeth. There are five other additional teeth as well. There are multiple irregular fragments of bone that appear consistent with skull. Many of the fragments reveal linear appearance consistent with fragmented digital bones. Now, with David's, it says, where's the internal? Where is it? Okay. Examined separately from the body at the time of autopsy from a sealed brown paper bag labeled with bone fragments near his body are multiple fragments of bone and hair. A maxilla with well-preserved natural teeth showing no metallic restorations is present. Multiple 1.5 to 14.5 centimeter maximum dimension skull bone fragments articulate well with each other and with the remaining calvarium. So they not only go together, but they match David's head. Match the calvarium on the body of the decedent. A separate non-articulating 8.5 centimeter maximum dimension skull bone fragment has a rounded defect along one edge with apparent internal beveling. And then it talks about
right
the
here,
rest of
right
the...
here under the internal evidence.
Right, that's what I was just reading.
Yeah, large fragments that appear consistent with skull.
Yes, but that's not the pieces we're looking at. Are we talking two different things? Okay.
I don't know.
That's well, all
I just
know
remember
is...
that I found that somewhere because I made a note of it.
Okay. There are, okay, yes, larger fragments, but so we know that they're larger than what, the 1.2 to 8 centimeters? Is that what they're trying to say? I don't know. Is that what they're saying?
Well, I think that's kind of the problem is they're very detailed with a little more detailed with David's skull pieces and all that stuff. With this, it's just like, oh, yeah, we found some. But so that's what made me kind of question, well, whose are they? Which ones are we looking at? And if they found larger fragments that appear consistent with skull on both of them, which is what I'm reading, I'd like to see this one too. Maybe this might have some interesting.
Well, yeah, and not only that, if you're when we're looking at this, for one, they're not saying how much larger, and to say larger fragments is, it's not clear at all.
Well, how,
but
how,
it doesn't state whose body did it belong to. Was it in the right place? Was it with the right body? With David's, the two pieces that were right by him clearly fit him because it says they fit together and they fit the remaining skull on David. But with Camille, it's like it's so unclear.
Yeah, it's vague. It's very vague. But it's vague, there.
That's the word.
And these autopsy reports are also located in the group files for anybody listening to this video. So
yes, and please don't go crazy the way I did looking at them because it can drive you crazy, especially if you have no idea about any of this stuff and you're trying to learn it like me, trying to learn all the stuff at the same time of trying to research it. Not a good idea. Not a very good idea because you can make conclusions prematurely. So that's
Catherine.
Been my fault.
Yes.
Sorry, Greg.
No, go
ahead. The audience is wanting to know whether they were scalped.
I would have to say no, because when we're looking at those photos that we're going through right now, there's clearly skin and tissue on the leftover of the bone itself, because you see the decomposition taking place on that skull piece. What we see right there is skin. I'll wait to. Can we get a close? I know you have to wait. I'm sorry, I forgot. I'm speaking too fast.
No, it's okay. People are seeing this. Yeah, they're seeing it.
Yeah.
Could we please get a close up? Because there's also another thing I'd like to point out.
What do you want a close up on? Maybe I should just pull up the actual image I can.
Well, you know the one you had that was really clear of the, what is 4764? I think you had a really good close-up of that one where it was clear. As part of your slideshow.
4764?
Correct.
Okay. Jump into 4764. Little time travel. There it is.
Time travel. Okay. Yeah, and I'm pointing at my screen, and I keep forgetting you guys don't see my fingers. But you, what you are seeing there, you see the green and the white and the brown and the purplish colors. That is all the skin, and it's decomposing. It's in a state of decomposition. So since that is flesh, it's not scalped away.
Tell me where on this image, to my cursor, left, right, so.
If you could try to focus a little bit more on, just go in a little bit more towards the words.
Towards the words on this?
I'm wanting the audience to see the scalp part or the skull piece, the details of it.
I think the next one, the next photo, there you go.
OK. Okay, Sophia, give us a few seconds for you to catch up.
Okay. We're waiting. Sorry, folks.
Should be coming up. One more. Okay.
Okay, there we go. If the audience can look at the edges of that skull piece, you will not see any scratching or teeth marks whatsoever. The dog did not chew on this skull piece. You don't see any lines from the teeth grinding against it or anything. That's what I really wanted them to see. That and the fact that the skin is still pretty attached to that skull piece.
Yeah, it is attached, and that how it looks like a marbled effect. It's called mottling. It's mottled. That's just all what happens as the decomposition process continues within the tissue itself. So we know that the tissue is attached to the skull bone itself. So again, it's a safe bet to say, best guess, no, they were not scalped, from according to what we see here.
So how does the hair get away from here for us that have no idea?
Well, the hair, it usually comes out about, they say 30 days, but that's with an attached scalp and head. Since this was torn apart, broken apart, ripped apart, batted apart, who knows, the blood supply, what's going to be holding that hair in that scalp is missing. So the fact that it's going to come out and has come out is not surprising. It wouldn't have stayed attached like it would in a head that was not broken apart. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Let me go back. 4760. You know, this is why it's so great to have so many people looking at these photos, because somebody always finds something. And
with these close-ups, you can clearly see the blunt force trauma. And for the longest time, I wasn't on board that train. I didn't see it. But once Catherine pointed it out to us when we were talking Sunday privately, mm-hmm. it was super-duper clear.
Yeah, and I'm going to cover that again in when we're going through, again, more of this, probably the third part. I think the second part we're going to be covering the metadata, and the third part is going to be the blunt force trauma as well. So I will go over that in much more depth because, I mean, those impressions, once you see them, you can't unsee them. You know, you know they're there, but if you don't know what you're looking for, it makes it harder to see.
Correct. And this is the outside of his skull. Because the skin is attached, the inside would not have skin.
Correct.
But I'm just clarifying for yeah. everybody listening. But
thank
now
you.
We have at least 26 people listening. Wow, this is a great live stream.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's awesome. Again, welcome aboard, everybody. If you have questions, please feel free to type them in.
Yeah, I feel like we're missing a lot of good chats here, a lot of good information. That's
Oh, it is on fire tonight. I'm trying to keep up with it.
I can't keep up.
And let the cat in and out.
I'd help you, but I can't see anything other than what Greg's doing.
I'm looking. This is the one I want to
try to catch up.
Yep.
Yes, Stephanie. It looks purposely staged. And when we have our conference call next Thursday, we're going to be talking about staging of this crime scene. So I hope that all of you listening can join us, because it's going to be a great conversation.
Oh, and there's something else. Yeah, yes, so please, everybody, join next week. This one right here, and Greg, can we... is to show another part how this was moved, and this is just showing movement of the skull piece. Again, I'll cover the other stuff we had talked privately about the next time, but right now, you see how in the lower left-hand portion of that skull piece, how it's close to the, I don't know, you want lined section of the scarf?
Let me zoom in there.
Yeah, you see how it's like right there? Oh God, I'm pointing at my screen and you can't see what I'm doing. It's like, stop pointing, it's not helpful. But you'll see where the lower left hand is touching like the like down a little bit. Yes, right there, that section right there. Now let's compare how that moves as well. How that portion of the scarf and skull move away from each other in the other photos.
Okay, so here's 4760. Pay attention there. And we're going to go to, I'm going to skip that one. All right, skip that one. We're going to go to 4762. This is 4762. I'm going to zoom in a little bit there. And I'm going to go down, 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 down. And it's probably a little hard to see. Maybe I can back.
Yeah, that one's a little bit.
That one's a little hard. Okay, so 4.76. So maybe 4.763. Let's see if that one will give us a better idea here. So 4.760, 4.763, probably the two to compare. Right? Or are they the same?
Yes. So yes. Yes. 4.760, 4.763, and 4.764 shows an even
better
bigger
one?
Gap.
Okay.
Yeah, it's moved even more.
See right here. So I'm going to look at this arch. I'm going to try to follow that arch as my mark. How about that? Okay.
Joanna Love would like to know if you could explain the connection of the scarf.
What does she mean, the connection of the scarf? I mean, all we know and all we can really say is that there's a scarf there. It was white and black or dark green, whatever the color is, because it's hard to tell with all the blood, and that it is part of the crime scene. We know Kamel had one that was like that, but we also know that Danny August Mason wore one exactly like that in several different photos, especially in the shooting scenes when they were doing the winter scenes of the trailer. He wore one exactly like that as well. So there are two people who are associated with this homicide that had had the exact same scarf, but we don't know whose scarf this is. We don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Dan has also joined us here. Dan, can you hear us?
Hello, I'm here, yes.
Hey, Dan.
Hey, Dan.
Hello.
We can hear you.
Bye, Jacob. Well, do you have anything you want to add, Dan? Or you probably have lots of stuff to say.
I am just getting caught up here now.
It's definitely
nothing yet.
Yeah, this the scarf is. I mean, it's. You can clearly see where that arch is now.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to look a little deeper into that, the same way I did with this. But that's
Yeah, because you don't really see much of anything. There's a little bit of a shadow between where the skin is and where the scarf is, and then in the other ones you see there's a much bigger gap.
Yeah. You can see this little loop here almost goes right into the right in there. 4.62. Here's 4.60, and that loop should be right here. This loop here,
yeah, but it's,
I think,
yeah,
should be right here.
Yeah, and it's not. There's only, yeah.
Now, if somebody, let's look at the south end of this, and if they're taking photos while they're on the shawl, I don't know why they would be on the shawl, but if they were, that might move, because it's moved very slightly, right? And I think that's
I see it as more than slight. It looks at least to be a half an inch of movement of material, and that's just a guess. I and that's just my opinion. Maybe others won't agree and they see something different.
Yeah, to me it looks just very, very slightly moved. And moving in this image, it would be moving to the left, that skull piece is basically what you should follow, where that skull piece is, and why is it moving to the left? Is it decomposing in front of our eyes? Within seconds?
No. Hey, miracles can happen.
If we pour some water on it, is it going to grow? I mean, I don't know.
Help me, I'm melting. But, yeah.
Even this scarf here, being here, was one of the things that made me think, oh, the bodies are definitely moved, right? Everything is moved.
Mm-hmm.
The bodies are moved by this point. And the consistency of the photos. Well, that's what I'm going to go back to. That's what I wanted to go back to.
Paulette wanted to know which way was south from these photos.
Okay, so...
Is there any way to determine that?
You would have to know where 4, 5, and 6 are. So pay attention to where 4, 5, and 6 are here. Okay? And then let's look at the crime scene drawing here. And you can see... Well, I guess that's kind of not the best way. If I could flip this over... you'd probably see, so if I could flip this 180, you'd see it.
Four would be like the southeast, correct? Or southwest?
So they were looking, so you have to look at the, okay, so this is, this area here that my cursor is on, this is south. This is south.
Okay.
This is north up here. This is west. And this is east. So think of it like that. I know the photo,
okay,
the way they do the photos kind of.
Yeah, then number 4 would be closest to the south.
Correct.
But that's, again, but you made a good point, Greg. How do we know how much was that moved? We don't know. But
right.
Still, I would think 4 would, according to their sketch, the number, the tent, the yellow tent, number 4 would be more south, right?
Correct. That's correct.
Okay.
That's right. Okay. So the wall that the neighbors saw the bodies through would be here.
Okay.
That's 4760, 4762. So that's where it kind of 4763. And see, that's the other thing. They're like doing like a 360 panoramic view here of all of these photos. I don't know if they're moving around. Then, you know, isn't it possible that everything else is moving around?
Well, they were standing on a step stool, and you can see that, and another person had pointed that out, too. And
yeah, they're not.
I believe Sharon did.
Do we know what image that is, Sharon?
Well,
we have to look back at the photos.
Okay.
I mean, when they're documenting a crime scene, they are not to interfere with anything, with any of the evidence. They're just there to photograph it. And if they interfere, again, that comes back to they need to document what they did and how it moved. And nothing was done. But you're right, how they're doing, it's like they're all cockamamie, the way they took these pictures. It's ridiculous.
Well, and the order, because that's one thing I wanted to, I threw myself off a little bit. Let me go back here. Oh, come on. My computer never freezes. How dare you? All right. The order of these images, it's like all of a sudden they're here and then they're like, they're portaling into another room or something. So that's...
Did you say portaling into another room?
I don't know if that's a correct term, but yes. It's like, well, here we are here, right? We're all of a sudden, and then boom, we're just going to all of a sudden take... These are not in order. And that's what always bothered me about the original 464 photos, is they weren't in order, and I thought that they were. And so looking at some of these things, you know, you talk about things being moved, you can clearly see the things that are moved in David's bedroom, where these things right here, all the stuff that is on this shelf, and in other photos it's on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, well, that's weird, but then I was like, well, at least they took photos of it to show where everything was.
Yeah, and it's an obvious movement, you know, and you when you look at that, you're like, okay, this may have been out of place, but you know they're documenting behind where those books were. They They took a photo, they took them and moved them, took a photo of them being moved, and that, even though it might not make sense, it makes sense. But with these, the photos of these skulls, where it's subtle changes of movement of the skull on the paper, that is not normal. And especially with their timestamps. I mean, there's something afoot here with these three or four photographs.
It can't just be an honest, simple,
And I would have thought that if it was just one picture to the next, but four different photos, four different movements.
Yeah.
That's not an honest mistake. That's not an, oops, I kicked the skull, let me put it back.
Dan, did you want to add anything in regards to this?
Could he go muted. Get coffee?
Probably.
He could be muted on there, but yeah, it's like, okay, here we are here in one room, and then all of a sudden,
oh,
bam.
I'm sorry. I was on mute.
It's okay.
We were just wondering if you wanted to add anything, like your thoughts on the skull piece being moved throughout the photos.
Yeah, I think it's very strange. I'd like to get another interview with Russell in the next week or two to have him get his thoughts on that, because like Catherine said, the photographer's job is to take the photos of the crime scene, not to be moving, touching, or manipulating anything. Their job is simply to take the photographs. And so what we see here is things being moved about, and I'd like to get someone's thoughts on this, for instance, a person like Russell.
Yeah, I think that would be good.
Yeah, Dan, can you, for people who might not know who Russell is, can you kind of explain? Because he was a big help. I thought he was a very big help in somebody.
Russell, I've done a couple, for the newer members out there, I've done a couple interviews with him. He has got a pretty fascinating past of what he's all been doing in the past as far as his job and his career that goes way back, also in dealing with crime scenes and such. With forensics, and in fact he's taught a couple classes at the college level to do this type of thing, and I've had him on the last time, I think was back in April, and I'd like to get him on again to go through some of this. He's the first one who said that it was obviously a staged crime scene just by looking at what was at the Crowley residence, and so he first of all called it out a couple of years ago, saying it was obviously staged, the scene was staged by what was left there and by what was not left there. He said this is not a normal double homicide followed by a suicide. So it would be interesting to get his thoughts on something to this effect.
Yeah, be curious. Well, hopefully, Dan, you can make that happen. I think we'll all benefit from that.
Agreed.
Because, I mean, it just seems like it's one of those things where you're like, you know, how important is this that we're looking at? Does this clearly show a more proof of a staged crime scene? Or is this another honest, sincere flaw that the Mayberry cops just got involved with? You know, I mean, I want to give them the benefit of the doubt here, and so I want to start there. I'm not saying I'm going to end there, but I want to start there. Go ahead.
Four times, Greg? Sorry. Go ahead, Dan.
Sorry, I just want to jump in here. You guys may have covered this earlier in this broadcast, but what this does is that it shows that whether the crime scene itself was staged by the killer or killers, what this shows tonight is that law enforcement now are no longer off the hook, because they are now complicit in moving or manipulating the evidence at a crime scene. These photos were taken with the skull piece here, as we're calling it, moved in various photos. This is not something that the bad guys or the criminals or the people staging the scene did. This is manipulation by the detectives and or the BCA special agents in that house that we now have documented that things have been altered, and that is in itself a crime.
Correct. This is basically enough
that this is all we need essentially to get this case reopened, in my opinion.
And Dan, what I was letting them know too is that how we will be able to back up that thought process is when we go over the timestamps and how that proves that the timestamps are incorrect, that these were moved and manipulated. I mean, there's so much, like I was saying before, these photos say so much, it's hard to get everything they're telling us. But yes, this is no longer, no one is innocent anymore. It seems like they're all pretty much complicit. Is that the correct word? I'm tired.
I would say complicit, because unless we get Special Agent Scott Katsavitz on a call or on an interview or a live broadcast like this, Mike Katsavitz would be to get his thoughts on this. And I know this is coming up on 5 years ago, but it would be nice to get direct from the horse's mouth why in these photographs can he talk to or explain why they were manipulated. Would be a very good point to get live on the air, or his boss or his superior on the line to discuss these photographs. Over.
I haven't looked for his name. He's in there? I need to really.
It's in the metadata.
Okay. But I mean, was this Katsavitz guy, he's on scene, right? It's not just like it's his camera that somebody else used.
He's the one taking the photographs for
BC.
Well,
I think it's either him taking the photographs or Beth Ehlers taking the photographs, and he may be the one processing or downloading them. I'm not sure which one.
Oh,
yeah, well, okay. When I looked at the metadata, Dan, some of the photos said taken by Ehlers, and some of the photos said by, what's his name?
Katsavitz? Oh, good.
Katsavitz. But yes. Regardless of who took the photos, the date stamp and the metadata on these actual photos from the BCA has got Mike Katsavitz's name all over them.
Yes.
And not.
He'd be the first person to talk to. He may point the finger at Ehlers to say that she took the photos, but there's still a responsibility in the metadata as him being special agent on scene with the BCA, the Minnesota BCA.
Do you think they were sharing the same camera, or do you think just...
Well, they should not.
Well, regardless of who took the photos or who downloaded them, they'll have to answer that question.
Right.
Regardless of which one it is.
Okay, I see. So we just got to phrase it.
I'm assuming one person took all the photographs and one person downloaded all of them, but the problem therein lies with both of these individuals to at least answer the question.
I don't remember seeing Katsavitz's name on the list of people that entered and left the house, but... I'm trying to find that right now, actually. I know we have it somewhere.
I didn't see his name either. Yeah, it wasn't until, I think, when Dan picked it up out of the photo and out of the metadata that I started looking through all the photos, and that was the first time I remember seeing the name.
Yeah, that should be in here somewhere. It is in there somewhere, but that would be interesting to know if he was on scene or not, because it would be very interesting to know.
Well, does anyone in the group or watching, are there any more questions we need to answer?
They're like on fire in the questions right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm trying to catch up.
I'm trying to keep up. But I'm also looking for that crime scene sign-in.
Yeah.
It's
in the last BCA document. I want to remember if it's in the one Dan got, the 485, or if it was, it might have been in that one. Actually, no, I think it was in...
I'm going to run and get some water. I'll be right back, guys.
Okay. Yeah, maybe you can find that, Sophia. I don't want to dig through all of these.
I'm looking.
Okay. There somewhere. I know
Could have
that.
sworn
I thought I had added it
that I had it.
to my book. I wanted that screenshot in my book. Now I'm gonna have to add that in there, because that's a very important thing, because it clearly shows who was there and when they got there and when they left. I can't believe I didn't put that in here. No, I will. I'm gonna look in the chat room here to see what's going on. If anybody wants to
There we
make
go.
any new, even if you've already made some points, because we have just an awesome chat room right now. If you have any points that you want to make sure that we cover on this show, please go ahead and retype in those points, and we'll try to circle back to them.
Who was the officer again that was taking the photos? Special agent?
Beth Eilers? Or Mike Katzovitz.
It's one of those
Oh,
two.
okay.
This is the BCA person on scene was for sure Beth Eilers, and I believe that she may have been taking the photos. The metadata, when it was downloaded, I believe that date on the timestamp was January 28th, for instance, is when Mike Katowice's name appears in the metadata. So he may have been the one in charge at the office, downloading or transferring the photos from the camera onto the server. But his is the name on all of these photos, and only Beth Eilers is on some of the photos. But I believe she was the one probably taking the photos in that house. But either one of those two should be able to, answer the shenanigans that was going on in that house.
And video would definitely help, because we know that they took video of it too. So, they should have a clear answer for why anything was moved based on their video or et cetera, et cetera. Paulette was saying, are these the only photos that anything was actually moved? No, there
No.
are a few other things, and the biggest ones I think are in David's bedroom. That's where I don't know if you guys have noticed anything else, where things were moved, but his bedroom photos are where you can see sometimes they take photos of the vacuum in the closet, and then there's other photos where the vacuum is outside of the closet. There was the big Sharpie pen thing, where you have some photos of a Sharpie pen that is, let me see if I can even pull one of these up.
And I think,
DSC,
and I,
yeah.
this is Dan, and I think Paulette raised a good question as well, because some things are moved that we've brought up before. In fact, years before here, that I would call them immaterial to the crime scene, but the fact of the matter is things were moved. Today's show, what we're talking about is actual the skull piece of a body, that there's evidence of it being moved and or handled, and that's what was very alarming to me. Go ahead.
Right. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, and can I interject something? And it's not so much, yes, and the fact I agree that the skull piece was moved, but what bothers me the most about that is that it was put back to make an attempt to make it look like it hadn't moved. I mean,
Correct.
it's by a fluke that we found this, because it's like we were talking the other day, and it's like, how many times have we looked at this photo and it just never dawned on us?
Right.
And now all of a sudden it's like it's in our faces, and now we can't unsee it. So will we find anything else with any other photos? We may or we may not. But the fact that this skull piece was clearly manipulated, but then taken another photo taken in an attempt to make it look like it's in the original position, whereas like with the vacuum, it's in the closet, it's out of the closet, the books, it's in the container, it's out of the container, totally different. This, so that's what has me alarmed.
Different because it's because we're talking about a human body piece.
Well, just different why. I mean, it should not have been moved at all, because it is evidence. The vacuum's not evidence. They have to move it. They have to show it, okay, this is where it originally was. Now we're going to move it because we're going to look in the closet. Moved was when after the ME got there, she saw everything in situ and then said, okay, bag them. And then they're moved. But up until that point, nothing of the evidence in the body should have been touched other than, like, I don't even know, I don't know this much about it, but would they have needed to turn the bodies over to take a photograph of them? But I think they would do that at the end. Same thing with the skull piece. If they had to move it, they would have done it at the end of that series, but not just, okay, it was moved. Okay. Hi, I don't even know if I'm saying this correctly. I think I'm going in circles. I'm sorry.
No, you're right on point. Right on point. And I'm just for comparison to where that the Sharpie pen was in the master bedroom, in David's bedroom. Now all of a sudden you don't see it here. The Sharpie is on the ground, and there's some other things on the ground. If everything was on the ground, that would be okay. But it's just things like that. It's just like, even it's almost like even the way that they gave us these photos is all it's all staged. I don't know.
Yeah.
And they keep saying in the group, Nova keeps saying this over and over, they are not supposed to move anything at the crime scene while they're taking the photos.
Correct.
Is there a logical reason why police would, in theory, move anything?
I want to specify, they're not to move like the bodies in anything mm-hmm. like that. You leave that alone. But when they're going through, because they have to go as they're looking through things and documenting, like taking things out of a room or taking things out of a box to photograph to make sure that there's nothing in that, that's all part of the process. But pointing out, when you point that out here about the Sharpie, now see, that doesn't make sense. Because if it was part of the original scene, why is it not in this photo?
Right.
See, that just... But they would need to then move some of the stuff to take photos behind the books. Or, I mean, the scenes that they have of their bedroom, where it's just totally in disarray, that was not because of David or Camille and that they were lousy housekeepers. That's due to the stuff that the police were pulling out as they're doing their search of the house.
And
if that they have, is what I'm trying to say is normal.
Right. And if they have video of it, it should clearly show why. And they should have been videotaping the whole thing, right? There should
yes.
be no time where they're like, oh, we're going to turn off the camera now and turn it back on. So that's why that video is so important to have, because there may be, that would be the only way that I could justify that there is a logical reason why those body piece, why that skull piece, why anything, even the Sharpie, why all that stuff was moved. But
the thing is, though, is with the timestamps, and we'll get into that in the next one, we'll show that they cannot even come back with that as an excuse because of the time that they put on there makes that impossible.
Correct. We have them dead to rights right now.
Yeah, we absolutely
are moving and manipulating the crime scene.
Yep.
Can they change?
I would like to ask the young lady. I believe it was a young lady who said her brother was a police officer, and. Because this is something I'm not clear on. I think this is what they have to do, but I would really like to have some clarification. When it comes to body parts like that skull piece, shouldn't there be one of those measurement cards next to that skull piece alone to document that as evidence? Because that skull piece is evidence. Or am I thinking incorrectly?
Okay. Sure, she'll answer. That a few minutes.
I'm waiting for an answer.
I mean, they take like taking a photo. Here's a good example. BCA 4564 compared to BCA 4565. That makes sense.
Yes,
this makes sense because obviously you want to show it's closed, and we want to see what it looks like when it's open. Rania's toy is being moved. Does that make sense? They show a bunch of toys here in some photos, and then when you look in the BCA 4569, this is not how the toys and everything were found. So they were moved over here, almost like they were thrown over here. But
yeah,
they were not there in the original photos. That hallway, the hallway to her room, the area to her room was all clear. But that makes, I mean, if I look at this, if this is the only image that I look at, I think something happened here. She was moving or, you know, I mean, your mind can just wander. So I totally understand why it's very important to know exactly where everything was. And I think unless we get that video, you know, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough for them to really try to discount everything that you've found here.
And Nova said that she would ask her brother
then
message Greg the answer.
Great, thank you so much.
Okay, anything else here? Gone about 90 minutes. We got 30 people in the chat room. Wow, that's great.
Now, that's pretty much all I wanted to say for this first part and for today. And again, we will the next one we will definitely cover more of the timestamps. And again, as by the time we get done with all of this, I hope that the bigger picture is more blatant and more obvious than what it is right now.
And this is Dan. And a final thought here from myself too. Of all the videos that I have done on this case, the most popular video is one that I called "Crime Scene Photos Taken at a Crime Scene" versus "Crime Scene Photos versus Photos Taken at a Crime Scene." That has nearly 45,000 views.
Wow.
On that one video alone.
Nice.
That I went through and took some various, I took, I think, just six or seven photos that I questioned why the investigators even took those photos. But it does seem that the people out there, the members and the public as a whole, are very interested in videos that have to do with the photos, the photographs, the crime scene photos. That's one of the most common phrases on my website, too, that people are coming to look at for the Crowley case is the crime scene photos. And the fact that we've never even done a video on these four photos that were just simply brought to our attention gives us hope that there might be other things out there as well that, you know, we're coming up on 5 years that are just being unearthed now. But I know there's interest out there because anything to do with the photos, we seem to get a lot of hits and a lot of interest and a lot of comments. So hopefully this could spur some other things as well, and even some comments from, you know, people in forensics and the tech people, photographers and things like that at a crime scene, the crime scene techs. You know, how common is this kind of thing? It shouldn't be at all anybody manipulating, whether they're wearing a blue latex and a rubber glove or not while they're taking the photographs. Why are they handling pieces of the body itself and then putting the things back to make it look like they weren't moved at all? But that's just some of my questions and comments.
And if they manipulated this crime scene, have they manipulated other crime scenes in that town? Have people gone to jail or walked because of what evidence they collected and how they manipulated the photos? I mean, this is what is keeping me up lately after we saw this information or found this information out. I'm having a hard time sleeping because an innocent person could be in jail, or a killer or rapist even could be walking around in that town.
Correct. That's a fair question. Fair question.
Yep. And I agree, and I wholeheartedly, there's no way that to me, in my mind, in my opinion, that anything I've ever seen in this case even remotely hints at David being guilty. It all exonerates him. So, and I can't believe that people who have chosen this police work or this law work or whatever, however you want to word it, as their profession, do not understand what they did. And by doing what they did, and by coming to the decision that they did, they are willfully and mindfully allowing killer or killers to walk the streets. And that is what keeps me up at night. I don't understand it. I cannot fathom their reasoning.
I just don't even know what to say anymore in regards to that, because it's just, I had faith in the fact that at least the BCA would be honest. I had some questions about Apple Valley and their chain of command calling the shots, but after seeing this, I have a lot of questions, and it's really disturbed me.
Yep,
that's fair.
I agree. I agree, and for me, it's like, who isn't complicit? And now it makes sense why I didn't hear from the Attorney General's office. Why I didn't hear from the governor? Why I didn't hear from the city council? Why I didn't hear from the chief? Why he downright refuses to answer anything? Why I didn't hear from BCA? Why I've heard from no one? Now it makes sense. I don't understand. I don't have the reason, but it makes sense.
Can you tell us who actually took the time to respond to your request, to what you sent?
Nobody. The only reason I was able to get Gummert on the phone was because I kept calling back, and the chief, and I kept calling him. And of course, you know, you get the person answers the phone, and I'm like, can I speak to chief, blah, blah, blah. And so finally, the chief had Gummert call me. And Gummert just said, the response is it will never be changed. It is what it is. We're happy with our decision, and no matter what you say or do, we are not going to reopen the case. Wow. And that's on audio. I have that audio, which is one of my videos. Because as it is, as the disclaimer or whatever, here in Colorado, if two people are a part of a conversation, one person can record that conversation without the permission of the other person, even if they are a police officer. So, I mean, if Gummert had said at any point, is this phone call being recorded? If it is, I don't want it, then I would legally have to stop the recording. But he never asked. I knew I was recording it. It is a legal recording. And without that, I don't even know if people would have believed me if I had said, hey, Gummert's just saying, no, they're not doing anything. But you get it out of his own mouth. They're not going to do anything.
Do you think he would have changed his story if you hadn't recorded him?
He didn't know I was recording.
But I mean, do you think, let's say that you didn't, and then you had told everybody, you know, everything that you had talked with him. Do you think that if somebody else reached out to him, that he would have said, no, I never said that to Catherine?
To be honest with you, I don't even think he would even respond. I don't think he would confirm or deny it. He just wouldn't respond. That's my thought.
Yeah, the only reason that I ask is because, you know, we had a similar issue. I mean, we didn't record or anything, but Gummert had told Dan Hinnon, had told me something, and then had told Dan Hinnon something totally different. And so it was like, wait a minute. And then when I asked him why, then he, you know, he said that he was basically wrong, blah, blah, blah. So I'm just wondering, I don't know, just wondering his character.
And to be honest with you, I don't know, and I don't really want to speculate in that regard. I do speculate a lot, but in that regard, I really don't want to put words in his mouth, just because I think that would come across as slandering him or libel or something.
I mean,
so, I understand why you're asking. I'm just saying I don't know how to respond.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, when I listened to it, I just didn't, I don't know. I mean, it seemed like he was very, very honest. I don't see why anybody would question you on that. But
oh, they questioned the doctor.
Leon Kelly.
Yes, thank you. I had someone with me that day. I was not allowed to record that meeting. That's why I brought someone with me. So even though I had someone with me, and this person will only come forward if they absolutely have to, but, you know, I'm not going to worry about it because I know what he said to me.
Right.
He knows what he said to me.
Right.
And, you know, and I put it out there exactly what he said. I said in the video that he felt that, you know, by what he read, David was guilty, but he also said that if he had seen anything different, he would change his mind. So I have no problem, you know, putting out there what someone says. It doesn't mean I agree with them, but if I'm going to ask them a question, they're going to answer it. I'm not going to twist their words, but yeah. But in my personal opinion, can I trust Gummert? I wouldn't trust that man as far as I could throw him. I just wouldn't. My personal opinion, as a police officer.
So, how far do you think you could actually throw Mr. Gummert?
Maybe half an inch. I might get half an inch out of it.
Okay.
Can I ask you all a question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
In your honest opinion, after seeing the pictures and the skull piece being moved around and stuff, what do you feel about this case? I mean, how do you feel about it? Is it a complete cover-up? The police are in on the staging? Is this all fake? I mean, what is your honest opinion? I think that it would help with the audience listening at this point. I know it's kind of a difficult question. I'm sorry.
This is Dan.
Yes, Dan.
I would say that it's quite obvious that the scene was staged by the killer or the killers, but now we've got more ammunition that the scene itself was altered when members of law enforcement got there and afterwards, which is very troubling.
Correct.
Yes, and I agree with that, and I'll take it a step further, because I always like to open mouth and insert foot. It's my favorite thing to do.
Go for it.
When I saw that, and then when you know, when Dan pointed out the metadata, which I had totally forgotten about until he mentioned it, and I'm like, oh, wait, yeah, that can be manipulated. It's typed in and added later. And then when I went and I looked at it, and then it struck me, and like I said, we will go over that more in the next video, who actually manipulated the data, who was actually taking the photo, and how it's absolutely impossible, according to their information that they put in, for those to be moving accidentally. That reeks to me of a cover-up of a much higher level. But I don't know why. That's what gets me, is why are they doing this? What was so important about what David had to say or who he was as a person that they would go to this length and at such a high level? I mean, now I really wish that we could read his script, because it's like the man must have had something, but we'll never know. I don't believe we will ever know unless we actually get our hands on the script, why this actually happened. My opinion.
And see,
I'd be wrong.
And I feel exactly the same way. And you and I have talked privately.
Yeah.
About this too, and I feel the exact same way. You know, it's just, what did he have? What did he know that he was going to expose?
Yeah.
Oh, gosh. I mean, scary.
Yeah, and when I talked to my coroner friend, and you know, I just, you know, again, was having, I needed someone to vent to, just because, you know, just the shock of what I realized was, you know, it was quite a bit. And I just, you know, I just told them, I said, you know, I said, this little girl, I said, she was just 5 years old. She's just a baby. And their response to me was, I've seen children younger in this situation who were murdered in a similar circumstance, not the same thing, like they, you know, where a higher hit was done. And they don't care the age of the children. And that's what that's gets me cold. The most, the child.
Yeah,
that poor baby.
Cold.
Yes. That's, yeah, I lose a lot of sleep over that. A lot.
Well, the blunt force trauma is very, very obvious. It's very obvious that the dog was not gnawing on that skull piece.
Correct.
As some people had claimed.
Correct.
Now, there are some pieces that look like they have been, but not that skull piece.
And I think that's something we've all pretty much agreed on, that it's the chances that that dog did eat some of them and chew on some of that makes sense. I don't think the dog did not eat some of them, but to the extent of what they're saying, there's no way.
Mm-hmm.
No way.
Yeah.
Well, I've always felt like these little marks here, these little circle marks, and so Fia,
we'll
you,
go over
you,
that
yeah,
too
to
in the now. Next video.
Yeah. okay. Yeah, I'm jumping ahead. Spoiler. No.
Well, and I could see why you would think that at first, you know, because, you know, first glance, again, it makes sense. It's like, well, they still don't look like dog teeth, but still, it's like, looks like something might have bit into it, but like Sophia was saying, to make those types of breaks, and that's, the skull is hard. It would be more than just a little dot from a dog. And
yeah,
that flesh
would have,
there
like,
would have been ripped away.
It would have been scraping
yep.
against the skull. You would see actual scrape marks going mm-hmm. down with his jaw closing, so, and it's not there.
Mm-mm. No.
Well, so there's something here, so I need to know what these dots are. So if anybody knows about that, yeah.
Yeah, we'll go over that, and like I said, in the next video, we have several. We still have there's a lot of information in these photos.
Otherwise, we'd be here for hours.
Yes.
I know. We do need to shut this down here pretty soon. So
yeah.
We'll go through any final words. If anybody has any final comments in the chat room, I want to thank everybody for joining us here. If you have any final comments, I would love to hear those. My view on what we've just seen here, you know, do I see what Catherine sees? Yes, I see that this skull piece is moved. I don't know why. I'm not convinced that there was any malice to it, that there was a reason why they had to move it. I don't see any reason why it would be moved, and I think, you know, again, without that video, it's going to be hard for me to understand why anything like that would be moved in these photos. But I don't know. I'm just trying to keep an open mind to the possibilities of what might have happened here, but I do think that this shows more evidence of a staged crime scene, and I do believe that what I'm looking for first and foremost is anything that can help us get the case reopened, and it's things like this that I do think can help us get the case reopened, to force the investigators to prove their case, to either prove that David Crowley is guilty or to shut up and stop saying that David Crowley committed this crime. They can't have it both ways. They can't say that David Crowley is guilty of this crime but not provide any evidence. There is zero, negative zero, evidence that David Crowley is guilty. So it's frustrating for all of us. We have 31 people in this chat room right now, and I'm sure they're all frustrated. by the fact that we are supposed to believe. They want to brainwash us to believe that David Crowley is guilty, and they can't prove David Crowley is guilty. We have people that will continually contact us, that will stalk us, that will troll us, trying to tell us that David Crowley is guilty, and they can't prove David Crowley is guilty. It's not normal. It's not the way that people should act, and it does show that there is something bigger here. There's something bigger the way that I see it. This is not just about David Crowley. This is bigger for many reasons on many levels, and it is a spider web. It can be a rabbit hole that can, you know, can confuse you and just make you angry and make people just say, well, screw it, I just don't have time for this. But that's what it's supposed to do. That's their game plan. They don't want you to see any of this. They don't want us to see any of this. They want us to go away. And we're saying we will go away when you show us the evidence. It's that simple. It was that simple from day one, and we're 5 years later, we're still there. There's no reason for us to say that David Crowley is guilty without proof. It's just never gonna happen for so many people. And even the people that are acting like it is, they're just faking it. I don't believe that there's anyone out there who truly believes that David Crowley is guilty, unless they're mentally ill. I don't believe that they really believe David Crowley is guilty. You would have to be mentally ill. You would have to be.
Well said.
Correct. And everybody in the group is all saying that David is innocent, that they're beyond angry. What else? He's creative. He would have left a suicide note, and not just be vague. James wants to know what was the independent investigator's opinion.
We don't have one. We don't have one yet. We really don't. All of these 30 people, they are the independent investigators. Every law enforcement person that we show this case, they are the independent investigators in this case. Not people that have a vested interest in just regurgitating what the official theory says without doing their own research.
Oh, so true.
It is ridiculous. It really is. And that's how Hollywood works. There is a Hollywood tie to all of this, a big, big one that they don't want us to look at either. That's why they wanted us to think that David Crowley's project was dead. But for all of us that know that it was not dead, you look to Hollywood, and we can see everything that is going on there right now. It's been going on for years. It's nothing new. It's just, they're just being caught. Their hand is in the cookie jar. And a lot of people looking at this case are saying, we caught you guys. Your hand is in this cookie jar. You're saying he's guilty, and he's not.
So. Yep.
And lashing out at us is not going to make us go away. It's just going to piss us off and look harder.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right. And if that was their plan, then they've done a great job. They've done a great job at that.
Yeah. Dan's being awfully quiet.
I think Dan had to check out there.
Oh, okay.
But we're almost at the 2-hour mark. If anybody has any final words, I want to say go ahead and go for it, or else got to shut this down within a few minutes.
I'm good. I've said all I need.
I want to thank the people in the live chat. You guys have really been amazing tonight.
Absolutely.
And you are on fire. Oh my goodness. I can't even keep up with all the comments.
Yeah, and we're
going
to do this
so fast.
Yeah, we're going to do this again next Thursday, so we'll be back here live talking about this, talking about anything else, talking about staged crime scenes. So, I'm looking forward to that.
And next Thursday is a group conference call. So if you're interested in joining with us next Thursday, the 12th of December, please contact Greg and he'll give you the information.
That's right.
And if you're interested in photos and files, Greg's website has them, Dan's website has them, and I've uploaded a lot of files to our group. So please feel free to pick something and start digging because we could use all the eyes.
That's right. And Wednesday, next Wednesday at 7 p.m., I'll also be on Revolution Radio with Eric Spitfire, who was one of the first people that actually helped keep this case going. So we're gonna, hopefully we'll have some new information by then. I have some updates that I'm just sitting on, just waiting until I get some factual data from it. So maybe we'll have something by then, and then we'll come back here live Thursday, this same place, this same channel. And if anybody does want to join that talk, please do. And if you just want to hang out in the chat room, that's great too. Whatever you can do, however you can help, we got to keep this case alive. We got to, I mean, we are so close. And the more people tell us that we're never going to get anywhere, never, 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 never say never, even though by saying never say never, you're saying never in that situation. But we're going to continue this until we get some answers. And that's it. Keep pressing on. That's right,
Thank
Ellie.
You.
Keep pressing on.
Well, have a good night, everyone.
All right, good peeps. I'm going to go ahead and shut this down. I'm going to end this with a little 2-minute video that I made here. Otherwise, God bless you all and keep truth alive. We definitely need your help.
Amen.
Amen.
Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Good night.
Said the night wind to the little lamb. Do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
Way up in the sky, little lamb. Do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
A star, dancing in the night, with a tail as big as a kite. With a tail as big as a kite. Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
A song high above the tree, with a voice as big as the sea, with a voice as big as the sea. Said the shepherd boy to the mighty king, do you know what I know? In your palace warm, mighty king, do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Said the king to the people everywhere, listen to what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say. The child.